What is up, Loopsters? Today, we are celebrating Easter. Easter is literally my favorite holiday of all holidays. Do you know that? I don't know what holiday is your favorite, but if it's not Easter or maybe Christmas, then get out of town. Today, we are celebrating that Jesus lived, died for our sins, and lived again. Oh my goodness, let's worship.
When I'm drowning, oceans raging all around me, through the thunder and the waves, you're constant. You're my lifeline in the storm. See the waters rushing through this broken vessel. You're the calm within the current. Rising through the storm, you'll never leave me. It doesn't matter what I'm facing, no, when I'm failing, you're holding on to me, and I'm holding on to endless mercy. You had every right to leave me. All my sin had left me stranded. But your love has brought me home. You'll never leave me. It doesn't matter what I'm facing. No, when I'm facing.
Love, who would you say loves you more than anyone in the entire world? Some of you may be thinking of a parent, a grandparent, an aunt or uncle, or maybe a friend. But the Bible says that God is love, and His love is what makes us able to love others. God's love is bigger than anything we could ever face. And sometimes the things that are going on around us can make it feel like it's the end of the world. But when we stand and we worship God with everything that we have, it's like we're saying, God, you are bigger than anything I could ever face, and I can face anything because I know your love is with me. So let's do that right now. Let's stand, lift our hands, and worship to God because His love is faithful.
Take is from you. Hope is running through my veins, filling up my heart with joy unending. Love is resurrecting me. Your
Seriously, I'm still like up in the clouds about this Easter. I'm so excited. Before we get into the Loop Show, I want to ask you a question. Easter is all about surprises, right? The surprise that someone rose from the dead. What is one surprise that you've loved and one surprise that you haven't? One surprise I've loved is my friends threw me a surprise birthday party like 8 months after my birthday. It was a really big surprise and I loved it. Surprise I didn't love, I got some spoiled milk and put it in my cereal the other day. Didn't know it, took a bite. Pretty much puked. Just about puked into my sink. Real nasty. What was yours? This is where you find someone to talk to. Don't watch the Loop Show alone. Eva? even if you didn't get to talk to someone right now, I hope you got some time to think about it, because we're going to be talking a lot more about great surprises and not so great surprises in the Loop Show today.
Which one is gummy?
And which one is real? Oh, it's this one. That's an egg yolk. Hang on, Blue!
3, 2, 1.
Welcome to our Easter episode.
Happy Easter, Loopses!
This year, for our Easter celebration, we've invited our good friend Jason, who's going to come and talk to us about how one man saved the world.
Like Superman.
Well, actually, I think you're going to see that Jesus did things differently than anyone expected.
Hey, Loop. I'm Jason, and it's story time. And like any good story, this one starts way back, before math and science and puppies and chickens and eggs and sidewalks, before us. There was nothing, just a beginning, the beginning of everything. And the beginning was God, God in three parts, God the Father, God the Son, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. And the three parts of God were together. They were like chilling like family. Everything was perfect. It was so good that God wanted to share some of it with us. And so he made the universe and everything, and then we made sidewalks, and it was good, but then it wasn't. And it wasn't just Adam and Eve and some apple that messed everything up for us. No, all of us, one at a time, we've taken steps away from God. And here's the thing. Steps away from God is steps away from love and life, which is steps towards death and hate. And that is a problem. And so God sent the law as a way to delay death. But remember, God didn't just want to delay death. He wanted to give love and life. So he started getting the word out that he was going to send one man to save the world. And so naturally, people started expecting someone to come and kill all the bad guys and become like the president of everything who makes our lives easier. But God had other plans.
Since the beginning of time, people could tell something was off. The world was broken. Human beings were capable of building and doing good work, but also they seemed bent on destroying beautiful things. The Old Testament defines this evil that leads humans to bad choices. It's called sin, and it consumes hearts. People who followed God understood humanity's only hope was a savior who could take away our sins and save the world. But they had major expectations. They expected this savior would come to earth in a triumphant way, like in a rocket ship. But in reality, his birth was a small debut in a small animal trough. They expected their hero would be a warrior that would pick up a sword and lead a strong rebellion. In reality, he was a carpenter and demonstrated how to live in peace with God and others. They expected a holy exterminator who would burn sin out of the world. In reality, he traveled through towns, restoring lives and teaching how to say no to sin. They expected a political superstar who would punish all challengers. In reality, he called himself a shepherd and told us to forgive our enemies. They expected a bold king to come and immediately enlarge their territory. In reality, he took the role of a servant and spoke of God's eternal kingdom. They expected a judge to chop down the unworthy. But his reality was full of mercy, and he encouraged others to do the same. The expectation was vengeance. The reality was grace. The expectation was a battle. The reality was a sacrifice. Jesus came to save the world and reset our expectations from the past, present, and future. Because our expectation was death, but his reality is life.
Every time I hear the story of Jesus, I'm blown away.
Yeah.
Let's do an Easter challenge.
Let's do it.
Ooh.
All right, so this is the It's Gummy versus Real Easter Egg Edition. So there are two eggs per row. One has a gummy surprise inside. The other has a real surprise inside. So choose an egg, no picking it up and testing it out before you make your choice. Hold it over your mouth. Well, we'll count to three. On three, open the egg. Whoever gets the real egg gets to choose their egg first for the next round. All right.
Great.
So what do you think it's gonna be?
Okay, so my expectation is something delicious and nutritious, but reality, it's probably something delightfully gross.
Yeah, okay.
Oh, okay, so this is how we're gonna find out who goes first. One, two, three, shoot. Oh, there's thumbtacks.
I'm glad we didn't have to eat that. I got glitter, so that means I get to go first.
Darn it.
I'm gonna do this one.
Okay, so I got this one.
Three, two, one, go.
Oh, I just expected the worst. He got the worst, didn't he?
Yeah, these are cherries. Just feel like I just ate really juicy blood. I mean, it's just cherries.
Oh, well, I'm really glad. Looks like you have cherry lip gloss on.
Because I got the real cherries, I get to choose again. This one. All right.
Okay, and I'll go with this one.
Okay.
My armpits are sweating.
3, 2, 1.
There he is. Oh, sweetest fish. What did you get? Oh, no! This is sweetest fish. That means he got fish. I'm not making these connections very fast.
I got tuna fish. Sorry. I spit it on the floor.
That's why I dropped it to my mouth right here, right there. Here you go.
Oh, these Swedish fish are really sticking to my teeth. How awful.
Oh, yeah, how awful, JB. All right, well, I got the real thing, so I get to choose again. I'm just going to go with this one.
3, 2, 1.
Well, I think I know what Jamie got.
Oh, my gosh.
I got little watermelon gummies.
I got pickled watermelon rind.
Man. Am I glad I missed that one?
It's like a bread and butter pickle. I don't like bread and butter pickles. I like regular pickles.
Wait, keep that there. Uh-huh. Look, it looks so much alike.
It's good that it's all gone, huh?
Mm-hmm. Well, that.
You smell like. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to do that. It really does look like a slug on the table, and there's like a spit trail going behind it. My tongue feels numb.
I can't believe that we have 3 more. Eggs to go through.
Please, no.
Okay, so we will get back to that first story, but first, another one. When I was a kid, I loved bugs. Actually, I kind of still love bugs. Honestly, my kids and I have these big aquariums in our house, like full of plants and bugs. Don't tell my wife, she thinks it's just a lizard in there. Anyways, so when I was a kid, about 6 years old, I'm wandering around my parents' garden, and on the tomatoes, there's these 3 creepy crawly worms. So, of course, I run inside. I find an empty container of Andy's mints. I mean, maybe it wasn't empty when I found it, but why do you all of a sudden care whether or not it was empty? It was empty when I brought it outside. And I put leaves and sticks and these 3 green worms inside the container. I screwed on the lid. For the next few days, I would just watch it. Side note, if your parents ever try to limit your screen time, just go outside. This world that God made is so much better than anything you can find on a screen. Anyways, I'm watching this jar, and I'm watching these critters climb up the sticks and eat the leaves and poop out the leaves. And then one day, my world changes. There's no more crawling around, and no more eating, and no more worms. And my 6-year-old heart just dropped. And I'm looking, and I'm just thinking, and my 6-year-old brain wonders, is this death?
There was a religious leader named Joseph who opposed Jesus' execution and then requested to be given his body so he could bury Jesus in a nearby tomb.
And then a couple of days later, some women who had followed Jesus came to visit that tomb, and they found it open and empty. And they encountered these mysterious figures telling them Jesus was alive from the dead. So they run away terrified. Nobody believes their report. I mean, he can't be alive. They all saw him die.
Now, just outside of Jerusalem, a pair of Jesus' followers were leaving the city, traveling on a road to a town called Emmaus. And they were sad and confused about everything that had happened.
Then Jesus shows up, walking alongside them, but they don't know it's him.
Yeah, that's weird. Why couldn't they recognize him?
Yeah, it's an odd but really significant image for Luke. They're blind to Jesus for some reason. So Jesus asks them, "What are you guys talking about?"
And they begin to tell him about Jesus, a powerful prophet who they expected would rescue Israel, but was instead executed. Some women say he's alive, which is crazy. It's all too much. We're going home.
So Jesus tries to explain that this is what the Jewish scriptures had been pointing to all along, that Israel needed a king who would suffer and die as a rebel on behalf of those who actually are rebels. And then he would be vindicated by his resurrection so he could give true life to those who would receive it.
But it's still not making sense. They're as confused as ever.
Which leads to the scene where they sit down for a meal with Jesus. He takes the bread, he blesses it, breaks it, and gives it to them, just as he did at the Last Supper.
Yeah, this is the image of his broken body, his death on the cross.
And it's when they take in the broken bread, that's when their eyes are open to see Jesus. Then he disappears, and the episode's over.
So this is a story about how it's hard to see Jesus for who he really is.
Yes, this is brilliant. I mean, how could God's royal power and love be revealed through this man's shameful execution? How could a humble man become the king of the world through weakness and self-sacrifice? It's very hard to see. But this is the message of the Gospel of Luke. It takes a transformation of your imagination to see it and embrace Jesus' upside-down kingdom.
It's still there. The little slug watermelon rind. Staring at me.
Ugh. Let the journey continue.
Only three more left.
You got the real thing, so you get to pick.
Okay, I'm gonna go with this one. Oh no.
This one.
Okay, it sounds good. Three, two, one, go.
Oh, I guess I got the gummy something. I got something.
I only have to look at it until you get a sausage. What in the world is yours gonna look like if I gotta get a sausage? Oh my gosh!
A hot dog. This
is like I love it.
A hot dog, a gummy hot dog with all the
fiction.
All the fixes. How adorable.
Okay, I'm just going for it. Three, two, one, go. Oh my goodness. That's a gummy worm.
I don't even have to look
second.
At it.
Wait a second.
I know exactly what this is, JJ.
Oh my gosh.
I didn't even need to look at a single thing. I knew exactly what this is.
That is so disgusting.
What this is going to be. Cheddar flavored worms.
That's really disgusting.
Yep. What flavor was your gummy worm, Jamie?
I think it was strawberry lemonade.
All right, so this is our last egg, Jamie. And since I got the real gummy worm, I'm gonna pick this one.
Okay, I'm gonna pick this one.
Okay, here goes, Jamie. Three, two, one. Wait. Oh, okay, I got a gummy something. Debbie. I think that's ham. This is just a little piggy. I think it's ham or pork.
It's awful.
Spit it out, Debbie. I can't understand what you're saying.
It was awful. It's like a vinegar pig butt. It's a pickled pig butt.
It's a pickled pig foot? Oh man, I really dodged a bullet on that one.
Pickled pig foot.
Jamie, you'll be happy to know that we ended in a tie.
Okay, that's actually high five worthy. I feel like I lost though. That is evil.
I honestly wish that
yes?
Everything could have been gummy.
Yeah, I do too. That would have been really, really nice. You know whenever you dye your Easter eggs, you know the stuff that you dye it in? That's what my face smells like right now.
A guy named Paul wrote the book of Romans. He wrote it as a letter to people who have been following Jesus for a while and to people who are just meeting Jesus for the first time. Paul spends the whole book explaining that there are only two ways to live life. One option is a lose-lose situation. The other is win-win. He sums it up like this: "For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." You see, every person, from your grandma to your best friend to your worst enemy, has sinned. Every person has done something that has hurt themselves or hurt others. Paul is telling us that sin has a price that has to be paid. That's what this word wages means. Paul tells us that you can try to pay for it on your own, but sadly, sin is expensive. You can't pay for it with money or by being good or by doing good. It's so expensive that you can't afford it on your own, no matter how sorry you are. But thank God for Jesus. He never sinned, which makes his life the exact right amount to cover the cost of our sin and then some. To live a life filled with hurting yourself and others, and then to spend your whole life trying to pay for it, is lose-lose. But to let Jesus lead your life, and to let him pay for your sin, and give you eternal life with God, and to promise to never leave you, and to always give you a reason to hope no matter what, that's a win-win until eternity.
This last story starts 11 years ago on a Friday. A little 3-week-old baby girl gets sick. Her name is Mercy. It means God's favor, God's choice to give us grace. And that last sentence I said is actually a line from a song that her dad and mom would sing to her to help her fall asleep. On a Friday, Mercy starts feeling sick. And then on Saturday, she gets diagnosed with spinal meningitis. And then on Sunday, Easter Sunday, she's in the hospital and her dad takes out his phone and reads about what is spinal meningitis. And he finds out that for a 3-week-old, most babies don't live. And the dad's heart drops and his brain starts wondering, is this death? Remember the first story where God sends part of himself? He sends Jesus to save the world, to bring love and life. And then on a Friday, humans kill Jesus for our sins. And on Saturday, he lays dead in a grave. And on Sunday, Easter Sunday, Jesus does what nobody expects, and he raises back to life. These are more than just good stories. This is life. I'm the human who tried and failed to figure life out on my own. I'm that little 6-year-old boy with a jar full of missing caterpillars. And I'm little Mercy's dad. I was expecting death, but his reality is life. We're talking about God's favor, his choice to give us grace. Those little green worms didn't die. I opened that jar and I pulled off that lid, and sitting on it were 3 white butterflies. And little Mercy, 11 years later, she's not so little anymore. She's a looper like you. And just the other day when I was writing this, I said, hey Mercy, what's so great about Jesus? And she said, actually I wrote it down. She said, his love, his grace, and his forgiveness. Like, no matter what we do, he forgives us. She said, no matter who we are, he loves us. You're right, Mercy. God's been trying to share his love and life with us since the beginning. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. But there's still a lot of death in this world. Not every caterpillar turns into a butterfly, you know what I'm saying? And not every kid makes it, or not every parent's marriage makes it. That's why Jesus said, behold, I am making all things new, because he is still making all things new, and he can make you new, and all you have to do is choose Jesus and live life his way.
Okay. One clean up. Eggy pile. One man saved our world.
He fixed our reality.
And he fixed it with grace.
So today we're celebrating Jesus and his resurrection.
He is risen, Jamie.
He is risen indeed, Ricky.
Happy Easter, everyone.
Enjoy the ride.
All right, this just...
Okay. Yep. Keep going.
Jesus came to save the world, and Jesus came to save you. Let's bow our heads and pray. Father God, we thank you so much for your ridiculous love for us. We thank you that in spite of everything we've done or everything we could do, that you still loved us so much that you sent your son Jesus to die for us. God, I pray that every single one of us would feel your love in this moment, knowing that you love us with so much grace, with so much truth, that you see us as your sons and your daughters. You see us as people that are worth being loved. Still with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, maybe there are some of you today who you've never felt the love of God before. Maybe for you, when we talked about this idea of sin, that anything we do that hurts ourselves, others, or the heart of God, and that the wages of sin are death, for you, that made you feel this thing where you realized you were missing something. But the gift of God is eternal life through his son, Jesus. And what you're realizing today is that what you've been missing is hope. And that's exactly what Jesus came to give you. Because 2,000 years ago, Jesus came to this earth. He lived a perfect life and he died a brutal death on the cross for your sins and for mine so that anybody who believes in him would be saved. And then on the third day, God raised Jesus from the dead, conquering death and sin so that anybody could be forgiven of everything they've ever done, that they could be made right with God, living perfectly in relationship with him forever. And that is why you are here today, to say yes to Jesus for the first time, to begin a relationship with him, to be made new. If that's you, would you simply just lift your hand right now, saying yes to Jesus today? All over the place, people are saying yes, committing their lives to Christ. And we're gonna celebrate with them and pray alongside them in support. So repeat this prayer after me. Dear Jesus, forgive me. I'm a sinner. I need you to save me. I need your love. I need your grace. And I need your truth. I give you my life. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen and amen. We are so proud of you for making the best choice you could ever make in your life, because in that moment, you became a new person. You have a relationship with God and that changes everything. So please tell somebody, tell a friend, tell a family member, tell your small group leader so they can help you understand what it looks like to follow Jesus.
Today of all days is such a wonderful time to accept Jesus' sacrifice for you. You guys, I'm so excited. If you made that decision, could you find an adult? Find someone that you really trust and tell them about it. I want you to walk with someone through this, because it doesn't end today. It's gonna keep going. There's more and more steps. There's more. This relationship with Jesus, guys, it's deep. You can go deep with this. So I really encourage you, find someone, talk to them, and start digging. Also today's a day where Jesus died and rose again. It's when we celebrate that. So find a way where you can honor Jesus. Whether you made the biggest decision of your life to follow Jesus today, or you made that a while ago, I want you to find a way to honor Jesus today. You might just spend some extra quiet time. You might go back and find some worship songs and spend some time worshiping. You know what? There's a Bible plan on the YouVersion Bible app and at Bible.com. There's a Bible plan called What's Easter All About? It's made for the Loop Show. It's made for you. Just put it in the search bar and find What's Easter All About? So there's this old, ancient Christian tradition where one person says, he is risen, and the other person says, he is risen indeed. So let's practice that real quick. I'm gonna say he is risen, you say he is risen indeed. He is risen! I couldn't actually hear you, but we're gonna do it the reverse now. You say he is risen, and I'll say he's risen indeed. Go for it. He is risen indeed! You guys, thanks for celebrating Easter with us today. We're gonna put some discussion questions on the screen. Find someone to talk to about them. We'll see you later.